when working on the rights of LGBTI issues, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgenders and intersex issues, I am constantly confronted with the first three phases of the Ross-Kubler scale of grief: denial, anger, bargaining. This could be due to the Indian culture, which simply follows what has been practiced for long without questioning it, or due to the conservative attitude of sexuality brought in by the British. So it is not surprising that as a gay activist, I see the elephant in the room. And it is not just one elephant. Like the nesting dolls, or the Russian word for it is matryoshka, it is a series of elephants, one inside the other. You pull apart one elephant, there's one another inside. The first one, of course, is that gays don't exist in India. This was faced by Ashok Rao Kavi, India's first gay activist. When HIV came to India, the government of India had to face the fact that there are men in India who love men and are now getting affected with HIV. So it was HIV that pulled apart the first elephant. And the government of India had to face what it had long denied. But then there was the second elephant. Oh, it's a foreign concept. So depending on who said it, homosexuality came to India, it was brought to India either by the Central Asian invaders or the Indian youth were emulating the bad American capitalist vice. So like the British who called syphilis a sexually transmitted infection the French disease, and the French called it the Spanish disease, so was the source of homosexuality assigned to the enemy. But Kama Sutra has passages which describe male-to-male fellatio. Manusmriti has passages which describe purification rituals when a man has intercourse with another man. The sculptures on the temples of Khajuraho do depict homosexual coitus. But then comes the counter argument. Oh, it was not common in India. In fact, in the Discovery of India by the late Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, he says in comparing the Indian civilization with the Greek civilization, homosexuality was neither accepted nor very common in India. Maybe so. But is being uncommon reason enough to deny us a life of dignity? To deny us the right of cohabitation? Sadly, apparently it is so. Because the Supreme Court in its judgment on IPC 377 says in paragraph 43 that while reading down IPC 377, the division bench of the Delhi High Court has disregarded the fact that a minuscule fraction of India's population is LGBT. With due respect to the Supreme Court, do we have to be statistically significant to get our rights? And what number would you consider as significant? Once it was reluctantly accepted by our society that yes, there are gays in India, then efforts were to show that the cause of homosexuality was an unholy act, in this case, child sexual abuse. So the reasoning went that gay men as children must have been sexually abused by either men or women. If they were sexually abused by men, they liked it and developed an addiction for it. If they were sexually abused by women, they didn't like it and developed an aversion for it. Wow. But many gay men, including me, have never been sexually abused. Even parents have been targeted. They have been accused of faulty upbringing, especially fathers, through the unloving father theory. But again, many gay men, including me, have very loving fathers. No lack of affection there. Actually, it is the Indian psychiatrist who should have belled the cat. They have known for long that homosexuality exists in India. They have known for long that the DSM and the ICD manuals do not consider homosexuality to be a disorder. They have known for long that sexual orientation cannot be altered. And yet, barring a few exceptions, they have been a part of the problem. Dr. Vikram Patel says that the medical legitimization of prejudice has been a major contributor to the stigma against homosexuality. I personally know many gay men who have been told by psychiatrists, get married to a woman and everything will be okay. This is one cure parents delight in. Oh, it's just a passing phase. Once he is hooked up with a woman, he will never let go. Wow. What naive faith in our Menakas and Rambas and Uroshis. In 2016, I had requested the president of the World Psychiatric Association, Dr. Dinesh Bhogra, and the president of the Indian Psychiatric Society, Dr. G. Prasad Rao, to give us in writing a position statement on sexual orientation. I am very thankful to them for doing so. The fact of the matter is, homosexuality is a natural, normal variant of sexuality. But every time I try to see this in debates on TV or elsewhere, I am confronted by religious fundamentalists. No, this is unnatural. Why? Oh, it's not seen in nature. Who said so? There are hundreds of animals and bird species in which homosexuality has been documented. To just cite one example, the famous gay male penguin couple from the Central Park Zoo in Manhattan. When they were given females to mate, they refused to do so. And when they were given a fertile egg and it hatched, they lovingly raised a baby penguin called Tango. The name of the couple was Roy and Silo. So, if it exists, it is indigenous, it is natural, it is not a disorder, it cannot be altered, then there are only three choices that remain. A, to get rid of us. B, suppress, control us. Or C, accept us. I have been told many times, Bindumadhav, these things are accepted in America. Why did you come back to India? Go there, stay there. Out of sight, out of mind. It's a variation of don't ask, don't tell policy of the Clinton administration. And speaking of control, it is IPC 377 that has been a boon to this bigoted society. By criminalizing non-procreative intercourse, it has penalized a private act. I repeat again, a private act between two consenting adults. I repeat again, two consenting adults without there being a victim involved. Just try to imagine the plight and the stigma of this law on my community. But you don't, do you? Because to imagine is to try to understand. to try to empathize, to try to become more human. And frankly, yes, it is very hard work. Instead, it is easier to, like the hands of a clock, go through all these excuses one at a time to the final excuse before starting all over again. And the final excuse is, of course, the discourse on public morality, which is reflected in the submission given by the Ministry of Home Affairs to the Delhi High Court in the 377 case, that criminal laws should express and reflect public morality. Do you really think chaos will reign if 377 were to go away? Do you really believe that the Indian civilization will disintegrate if I am allowed to marry the man I love? Do you really think it is that fragile? I don't think so. Or, as Dattatre Hosableji, the Joint General Secretary of the RSS, said, he is in favor of decriminalizing consensual adult homosexual intercourse, but he is against gay marriage because he is against its institutionalization. I think that is the core. I think that is the elephant in the room. It is that the society is really afraid of. That step by slow step, LGBTI will get all their rights. The society will no longer feel that they are special, privileged or superior. It is this elephantine ego that refuses to accept the fact that we are equal to others. But whether you accept or not, we are getting there. That elephant in the room is shrinking and shrinking rapidly. 377 will go away. I know we will get the right of marriage, gay marriage and adoption. The only question is, would you like to be part of the solution? Or, well, let's talk of something else. How's the weather? Thank you.